Good to see you. Thanks for being at New Hope Community Church. Just a quick question. How many of you got the email this morning about how to get here? Did it help? Yeah. Oh, okay. If you're ready, I didn't know whether to send it, you know, this morning. How many people ever go online at this time of the day? Obviously, quite a few of you did, so that was good. As I arrived at 5 o'clock this morning, man, the bright lights are in the middle of the street and the barricades up, and I started to be annoyed, and then I said, okay, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. And then I got over my wanting to be annoyed because I said, you know what? I'm driving a car. I'm not walking. And so it wasn't all that bad, but I figured if I could save you a little time and confusion in getting here, that would be a good thing. Judy Hita, happy birthday! A little birdie told me you turned 18 today. 18, okay. Just reverse those, okay? Well, I thought 18 was right. Judy, I hope I look half as good as you do into my 80s, man. Incredible. For those of you who might not know Judy Hita very well, though she's been around here forever, but Judy Hita was a longtime Clovis Police chaplain. She was not only a chaplain, she was the chaplain, all right, the lead chaplain, and led some of the rest of us and tried to keep us out of trouble, but has done a wonderful job being engaged in the community. So happy birthday to you. Floyd, better treat you right. All right. Anyway, great to have you with us. If you are a guest at New Hope, this is your first time here, we are honored and pleased by your presence. There is a communication card in the pew in front of you. It's for our church family as well, but it's also for you. Let us know you were here. Give us some information, and we promise we will not beat on your door. We won't bother you on the phone, but through the mail, we're going to send you information about what goes on around here, what we believe, and how you can be engaged, and hopefully answer most of your questions. And we would love to get that information in your hand. Several things I want to highlight today. We do have a couple of sign-up sheets to go around. I'll get those started. Let me just get those started now. The two things which are on the sign-up sheets, on the top, this is in regards to Prison Fellowship Angel Tree. If you have been in the retail stores already, guess what's going up? Christmas. So we don't want to be behind the times. And we're going to talk slightly about Christmas today, but we have to with Angel Tree. Angel Tree is a ministry we've been engaged in for over 20 years. It is where we help to share the love of Christ with children who have an incarcerated mother or father or sometimes both. And one of the hardest things and one of the hardest times of the year is for those kids is Christmas when their parents aren't with them and they don't receive anything. And so inmates sign up for this. There's a process for them and their children to be involved in this, and we are involved in the next phase, and that is you can be a volunteer in one of three ways with Angel Tree. One, you could be part of a prayer team, and that is we want to pray for every single child's name that we are given, and so as a team, you would be given those names, and they would organize a time for you to get together and to pray for them, because we want this to go beyond just giving a gift. As God provides us opportunity to make connections, we want to do that. One small testimony, Bill and Lindsay Eccles, one time for several years, were our leaders of Angel Tree ministry around here. They developed a relationship with a young boy at about 7 years of age by taking the gifts, and they spent a little extra time. They followed up. That follow-up led to many more other follow-ups. They walked with him all the way through his graduation from high school and had a relationship with him that still continues to this day. And so that's not going to happen with all of them, all right? But we want to be prayerful and mindful of those that it would be helpful for. And so one way you can sign up is to be part of the prayer team. Number two is one of the call team members. And what a call team member does is you would join at an appointed time with others down at the Prison Fellowship office, which is near Fashion Fair, right across the street. And they give you a prepared speech that you will call the families where the gifts are going to be delivered to. They are given information from the incarcerated parent, and we have to verify that the information that we have is correct. Here's a couple of reasons that's important. Let's say he has two children that are in that house, but we find out with a call that there are three children in that house. Okay, we don't want that third child to be neglected, all right, or forgotten about. And so we verify that we have the correct information, the right ages. We find out that we have the correct address so that the delivery person a few weeks later isn't lost and going places where nobody knows what's happening. And so that call station is, it's all done over the phone. You don't see anybody, but you talk to them. You go through a prepared presentation and make sure that the information we have is current. And then the third way of involvement is you will actually come by the church on the appointed day, pick up the presents. They will have a bag by the family that you were delivering to, all the presents in a large bag, the phone number, the address, the name of the people that you're to give them to, and then you would deliver those, all right, to the residents that day. And we always send you out in pairs, all right? You never go alone with this, but you go in pairs. And so those are three ways you can volunteer to make a difference in our community by being a part of the Angel Tree. The second thing also has to do with Christmas. Christmas choir, all right? Going to get started in just about 10 days. So if you can carry a tune, they would love to have you in the choir. All right, Karen, I expect you to be in the choir. All right, I saw you. Say, I can. All right, so that is terrific. So Christmas is always a very important time. Christmas musical celebration is going to be a week earlier than normal. All right, if you haven't already looked to the month of December, Christmas falls on a Sunday. So that Sunday we will have some special services at different times than what we normally have. The Sunday before Christmas is when we usually do our Christmas musical, but we're going to do it the Sunday before that, all right? And the Sunday right before Christmas, we are going to be doing our children's musical that Sunday evening, all right? So just kind of giving you a little heads up. We'll get all those dates out in the next week or so. Let me get back to my notes, all right? Make sure I'm covering everything that I'm supposed to. Today, after the last service, is the Widow's Lunch Bunch, and they are meeting at Piazza del Pane Italian Cafe on Cedar Avenue. And there's information in your bulletin about that if you would like to join them. Pop's Marketplace, if you have something that you want to give away, get rid of, sell, you need an employee, you're looking for a job, take out the little card that's in the pew in front of you, fill the card out, drop it in the offering, and we will get it to the small group that is in charge of Pop's Marketplace. All right? Hey, guess what's happening in 2 weekends? You get an extra hour sleep. Okay? Time falls back. All right? Falls back. So that's the first weekend of November. Don't forget to change your clocks at that moment. Okay? Or you'll show up at a wrong time for church. Next Sunday, you've got an invitation in there. It's a reminder, Harvest Fest, next Sunday after the last service. That's going to be lunch on the grounds, bounce houses for the kids, some games, just to enjoy some fellowship together. And so that's next Sunday right after the last service. So hope you'll come prepared. If you come to this service, go home, change clothes if you want, come back, join us for the afternoon. We'll have a great time around here. Also, if you've been part of our homeless ministry, you can grab your lunch and then go over to the office, and there's going to be a brief meeting with the Blanket Chips and the Homeless Outreach Ministry, and they would love to visit with you, and that will be next Sunday afternoon. Remember the display we had over here of the 31 junior high kids in the Ivory Coast of Africa? All 31 of them are now funded, all right, for the next year. So great job, guys. Great job. We had a couple of folks just this past week take on two or three, all right, and finished it up. So we're really excited that all of them are taken care of for the next year. Last Thursday evening, I had the opportunity to be part of the recording of a TV program. It's going to be aired on PBS Channel 18 on November the 10th at 7 p.m. You don't need to watch it because I'm in it, but I think it's a worthwhile program for you to watch because of our community. Channel 18 wanted to do, it's the first of what will be probably three or four on this very similar subject. It's called A Conversation, The Cost of Freedom. And the focus of this first one they're doing in this conversation is centered around the Buchanan Eight, the eight young men that have been killed in Iraq or Afghanistan since 9/11. It starts with Hubbard Barrow, which is the fountain we have out here, and on to Tony Butterfield, whose family's part of our church. And there were eight from Buchanan, two from Clovis East, one from Clovis, a total of 11 from the city of Clovis. The eight at Buchanan is the largest number from any one high school in the entire United States. And so they wanted to do this. And so it's an hour program, and there's three panel discussions. The first panel is a group of military personnel from currently serving to retired, from generals to sergeants, from every branch of military. And they talked about why did they enlist? And if they're older, why? And some of them are currently recruiters. Why are our young people currently volunteering to serve? So it's a very interesting dialogue that takes place. The second panel, Mrs. Ulrich, the principal, known as Mama Bear from Buchanan High School, myself, and then Terry Barrow, the mother of Jeremiah Barrow, whose name is out here on this fountain. The three of us are part of the next discussion, and it's specifically about these young men and the impact on the families and on community. And I got to be honest, it caught me off guard. I thought after this much time that my emotions were well under control, but at times they were not. And so then the last panel is about the golf tournament, which comes up on November the 11th, the Hubbard Barrow Golf Tournament, where a group of Hubbard and Barrow's friends, the very first year after they died, got together on Veterans Day just to remember their friends, and they pooled a little money. I think they raised about $300, and they didn't know what to do with it, but they wanted to do something to honor their friends. Well, that has turned in now to one of the best It's a golf tournament that is sold out 2 to 3 months before the tournament shows up. And we've been able to give to the Veterans Hospital in Fresno, to their physical therapy unit, over $300,000 over the last 11 years. And so Andy and Mike D'Emmanuel are the primary reason over these last 8 years that it has grown so exponentially. But also there are a lot of the young women and young men who were schoolmates, classmates of many of these others who are actively engaged in working with the golf tournament that makes it so successful. So that's the last part of the program. So we'll just encourage you on November the 10th at 7 p.m. tune into channel 18. We had Carolyn Gilmore's memorial service here yesterday, and what a wonderful celebration it was. It was really fun for me to see the video that was prepared because I never knew Carolyn Gilmore apart from her sunglasses and her wheelchair. Okay, I never got to see Carolyn riding a horse. I never got to see Carolyn very mobile and very active. And yet in the video tribute to her, I got to see a lot of that. I got to get a taste of what that is. And one day I will get to see Carolyn again without the sunglasses and without the wheelchair. And that was the thrust of yesterday's celebration. And so thank you for all of you who helped. Her small group was huge. Once again, I'm gonna wave the flag of small groups. Those ladies took their small group and met at Carolyn's house these last several months because she couldn't get out. They were there during the last moments. They were here yesterday all with their same small group t-shirts on. They handed out bulletins. They directed people into the sanctuary. They helped set up for the reception afterwards and shared food. And many of you also brought food and desserts, and we're grateful for that. So we simply say thank you to all of you for once again making a difference, and kudos to that small group. Also continue to pray for the Tittle family. That service was here last Monday. Again, kudos to our high school group, our high school pastor. They did a great job preparing the other building. We had probably 700 people here for that memorial service last Monday. We can only get about 275 in here. We had another 150 over in the high school room that they had set up. They set up chairs in the pavilion so people could hear, though they could not see, but they could still hear the service that was going on. So kudos to a lot of folks around here for making that happen. But that family needs our prayer. Bob Horn, how many of you remember Fred Horn Incorporated? Remember that? Well, you remember what he sold? Yeah, chippings, malt, sawdust, all right, over off of Church Avenue, all right. Used to have all those trucks run around town that said Fred Horn with a big set of Texas, hey, we got some guys from Texas here, big set of Texas Longhorns, all right, on the sides of his truck. Fred Horn's son, Robert Frederick Horn, passed away. Lived up in Bass Lake, and his service was here on Friday. Fred Horn had just been to his cardiologist 3 weeks, got a clean bill of health for his heart, and he died of a massive heart attack. So when we have an appointment, all right, that appointment will be kept. And had a great time with his family. So just be remembering the Horn family. I know they would appreciate that. Let me wrap up this time of our service. In just a moment, we're going to see a short. Is that video clip our offertory, or do we have an offertory? We have an offertory? Okay, thank you very much. We're going to see a video clip in just a minute after I talk about this insert in your bulletin. You've had this about a month ago. This is in preparation for the Luis Palau crusade that's called Fresno City Fest, Fresno Clovis City Fest. I encourage you to go online and Google Fresno City Fest. There's a lot of information there for you. But today, the message is about making a difference in our community. And April 1st and 2nd is a chance for all the churches working together to make a difference in our Central Valley. And what they've asked you to do is think about five friends or relatives that you know who do not know Jesus Christ. They do not have a love affair with the Lord Jesus. Put their names on here. Write them somewhere where you'll remember them. Split this card. Tear it off, put this card in the offering or hand it to an usher when you leave today, and we make a copy of it. We are going to be praying starting in January for all the names that are turned in, but the office of Fresno City Fest has a prayer team, and every day they pray for every name that's turned in from every church throughout this valley in preparation for this event on April 1st and 2nd. I don't know about you, but I think God has a wonderful sense of humor that on April Fool's Day, there are going to be people who, through the foolishness of preaching, are going to discover the wisdom of the ages in the person of Jesus Christ. And it happens because you and I are willing to engage with our family and friend and let them know the most precious, important news they can ever have in their life, and that is the difference that Jesus can make for them. Not religion, but Jesus Christ. There's an event coming up this week for our high school and junior high kids. It's called The Movement. Our responsibilities as adults is to pray for that event. Our high school kids have been challenged for a week by Chris to invite a friend with them to that event at People's Church. They are hoping for 4,000 people to show up that night. Junior high and high school kids from all across the city to Fresno and Clovis. And they've been instructed, don't invite your Christian friends to come with you to this. Invite your unsaved friends. All right, so if you can imagine 2,000 Christian kids in this town bringing 2,000 of their friends who don't know Jesus, and if just 50% of them find Jesus, that's 1,000 more kids cut loose in this city who have a relationship with Jesus Christ. So please be praying for that event Wednesday night. Then for the rest of us, November the 17th at the Save March Center, there is going to be an evening event of worship and encouragement. And it'll be great worship music, and the encouragement is going to come from Luis Palau himself, and Francis Chan is coming down from San Francisco to be with us that evening. It is a free ticketed item. What that means is you need a ticket, but it won't cost you anything. So you can go online to Fresno City Fest, and you can print out your ticket, okay? Next Sunday, for all of you who just don't like to do that kind of thing, I'm going to take a show of hands, and we will try to print those tickets out for you, all right? But don't be lazy. If you can, do it on your own. Okay? Do it on your own if you can. All right? Makes it much easier for everybody. But that will be coming up November the 17th, and we'll have more information for you next week. Just a little tip of the iceberg, if I can direct your attention to the screen. We'll turn off the lights, lower the shades real quick, and we're going to watch a one-minute clip about this special event coming up on the 17th.
Fresno City Fest with Luis Palau is coming to the Valley. It all starts November 17th with a powerful night of prayer, renewal, and worship.
My name is Francis Chan, and I'm excited to join you for the Renew Conference.
This is Luis Palau, and I want to encourage you to join us at the Renew Gathering.
Our unity plays a huge role in this as we step out together in faith.
Join us for Renew with Luis Palau, Francis Chan, and a free concert with Jesus Culture music artists Derek Johnson and Ruthie Ridley.
We give you all praise that we can bring.
I hope that you'll join me and Luis Palau for a night of encouragement, a night of digging into his word, a time of worship as we share our common heart for this city.
November 17th at Save March Center. Register for free at goodnewsinthevalley.org. That's goodnewsinthevalley.org.
And that night is to bring the churches together in our community and understand we have one purpose together between now and April 1st. and see if we can't all get on the same page. Some of you may remember, most of you probably do not. Today we will be taking two offerings. We'll be taking one at our regular time. We'll be taking one at the end of the service. I shared with you several weeks ago, this was coming up, that today as we talk about making a difference in our community, one of the ways we can be engaged in doing that is becoming participants in this event in as many ways as we possibly can. One is through prayer. Another way is through financial contribution. These kind of events don't happen without some financial resources. As a church staff and board, we have invested in this already. But as I shared with you a few weeks ago, things are a lot more meaningful to us when we have personal investment. As one guy said it, when you have a little skin in the game, it makes all the difference in the world. So whether it's $5 or $10 or $25, an offering at the end is going to be taken and is going to be going directly to the resources necessary for the Fresno Clovis City Fest. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward now and receive our regular tithes and offering. Gentlemen, if you would come, please. We have 45 men. Well, about 42 men now, because three of them came down the mountain. Up at Shaver Lake, they were on a weekend camp out, and I drove up for 3 hours yesterday afternoon. They all appeared to be behaving themselves, but to those of you men who were here, I'm going to tell you what those men up there said. They said, you won't have any men in church today because all of us are here. I'm just here to tell them they're dead wrong, all right? So I want you to lie. I told them that the really spiritual men of New Hope would be at church today. So any, would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, we love you. Thank you for the joy of knowing your Son, the Lord Jesus. Thank you for the joy that you bring to us in life. Even when life is sometimes hard and harsh, even when you have to have jury duty all week, you can find a great sense of joy in seeing you at work in the most frustrating and challenging of circumstances and situations. We thank you for the joy that you bring in moments of sorrow when we know that those that we love love you, and even though they are absent from our presence, we know they are face to face with you, and that brings great joy to our hearts. Thank you, Father, that even in church we can laugh a little, even when the world seems to be facing great challenge. Father, for our men who are up the hill, we're so grateful for their time together, and even though they are absent from us, we are grateful that you are right in the midst of their presence today. Thank you for the fellowship and the friendships that are being developed because of this time together. Father, for the families who have had services here this past week and have experienced loss, thank you for the care and the comfort that you have demonstrated to them through family, friends, through folks here at New Hope Church in trying to make a difference in a difficult time. For those who are facing health challenges and difficulties, Lord, we commit those needs to you. There's so many who are going through cancer treatment and kidney stones this past week and all other kinds of challenges. Thank you for your availability in and through each and every one of those circumstances. Father, for Luis Palau, you have blessed his ministry literally around the world. In fact, Luis is probably better known in the rest of the world than he is here in the United States. But thank you that he is salt and light to the world, and he brings a message that you have blessed. You've given him the gift of evangelism, and literally millions of people through his lifetime have come to know Christ because of his preaching. And Father, we pray that many more will be added to your kingdom because of his time and his investment here in the Central Valley. May we as a church family, may the fellowship of this church not just say, hey, oh, our pastor's excited about this, but may each one of us get excited about the opportunities that you are affording to us in the days ahead. For your blessings upon our willingness to give, we say thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The words of that song were a bit of a salvation for me earlier this past week. As some of you know, I had jury duty. I still have jury duty. I show back up tomorrow. I'm not sure judges are politicians, are they? Are judges politicians? No, they're not. They're not always truthful. This was supposed to end Thursday, and it might end by next Thursday. It's been a challenging week, and yet the whisper every morning as I head for downtown is, remember, the message series this month is Make a Difference. And so I really hate it when God uses his own sermons against me. But it's what is supposed to happen. And so we've attempted to do that in the midst of juggling things around their schedules. And here's the good news out of it. We do have two families who tell me they're going to come visit New Hope when the trial is over. So that's good stuff. One of them happens to be a neighbor of mine and Shelley's, just kind of around the corner and down the street a little ways. And her husband were at a wedding we did over on the coast this summer. And so have said, you know, we've been meaning we need to start going. I think God's telling us we need to come to New Hope. And I said, well, I'm not going to argue with God over that one. And then another was a lady who's just moved to town from Gilroy with three teenage children. And she had just started attending a church with a friend in Gilroy for about a year. And she said, I loved it. I didn't realize. She said, I told my friend no for 3 years and finally went with her. And she said, and I just want to get back to that. And so God, in spite of putting us in circumstances that we don't necessarily enjoy and or appreciate, He can make a difference. Also, today's message is focused on making a difference in the community that we live in. You know, Jesus gave directions to the disciples that they were to be witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the world. And that tells me that God has intentions for all of us to somehow find engagement in ways that does make a difference. It starts with us. It spreads to our family. It involves our church community. It reaches to the city that we are a part of and then beyond. And so today, our focus and our attention is on how do we, who've allowed Jesus Christ to make a difference in us personally, working together by his church, make a difference in the community in which we live in. I believe that is part of our privilege and also responsibility as the children of God on the face of this earth. So I'm going to invite you to turn to an unlikely passage for this time of year, and that is Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19 is mostly read in the springtime. It's not often read in the fall. You will discover what I mean probably when you get there. This is an Easter time message, all right? At least context. But today we're going to use it for making a difference in our community. We're going to look at a passage of Scripture that's probably got a title at the beginning of verse 28 in your Bible that says the triumphal entry. This is the moment that's beginning the last week of the life of Christ on the face of the earth. He has been engaged with 12 disciples for approximately 3 years in and around the Jerusalem area, letting folks know who he is, that he is the Messiah. He is the one who has come to take away the sin of the world. The people in Jerusalem are not looking for a spiritual healer. They are looking for a political leader. They are looking for somebody to overthrow Caesar and the influence of a tyrannical government upon their shoulders. But Jesus did not come to change their politics. Jesus came to change their spiritual poverty. Jesus came to be the king of their lives, not the king of their nation. And that is still the desire in the heart of Jesus Christ today, is to be the one who sits on the throne, the decision-making process of your life. Jesus still is engaged in offering an invitation to men and women and young people, come and follow me. Go where I lead you. Say what I give you to say. Do what I empower you to accomplish in your life. And he's still looking for men and women and boys and girls and churches to make that difference in their lives so they make a difference in the place in which they live. If you've been around New Hope very long, you know I have a different title for this section of Scripture, and it's the not-so-triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. And the reason is the people who are celebrating the arrival of Jesus are celebrating for the wrong reasons. And they shout for him one day, and they crucify him the next day. They say one thing out of their mouth, they do another thing with their life. And so that is the context of what we are going to look into. And I'm going to read several verses just for the purpose of getting to one verse. Follow along if you would like. beginning at verse 28 in Luke chapter 19. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethpage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anybody asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' tell him, 'The Lord needs it.' Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners did what all of us would do. They asked, 'Why are you untying my colt?'" This would be kind of like, some of you have a Corvette in your garage. Who's here that has a Corvette in their garage? Okay, raise your hand high. Okay, very good. My Oaky friend, Mr. Phillips, back there. All right? He has a nice vet. This would be like somebody coming into your garage, all right, and starting your vet and saying, "The Lord has need of it." And so the question is, would you and I be as responsive, all right, to what the Lord needs from us as this particular individual was? His name is not recorded, so we cannot investigate him, but he let his colt go. I wonder if we would let our vet, our Mercedes, our Chevy, our Ford, whatever it is that sits in our garage, go so quickly. So they brought it to Jesus. They threw their cloaks on the colt, and they put Jesus on it. And as he went along, people spread their garments on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. It's very nice of us to recognize God for the big things he's done in our life. But what God wants our praise more for than anything else in our lives is that we praise him for who he is more than for what he has done. For what he has done is only a response of who he is. Blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." Do you get this? These are the religious pastors of the day. These are the pastors and the elders of the church of Jerusalem. Okay? These are the guys who, first of all, should have recognized Jesus for who he was, and they should have been yelling louder than anybody else for who he is and what he's about to accomplish for the sake of the world. And instead, they tell Jesus, "Would you tell all these people to shut up?" And Jesus says to them exactly what Milo said to us today. Milo quoted Jesus today. "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." As he approached Jerusalem and he saw the city, he wept over it. That's the verse I wanted to get to. He saw the city and he wept over it. Jesus is about to enter Jerusalem in this triumphant manner. His ministry and his life have literally been prophecies fulfilled. Over 400 prophecies written hundreds of years before the life of Jesus are all ultimately finally being fulfilled in this one life. Just this entrance into Jerusalem is prophecy fulfilled. Jesus ascends the Mount of Olives. That is a mountain range on the eastern boundary of Jerusalem. Jerusalem sits at the base of the Mount of Olives, and from the crest of this mountain, you can see one of the most beautiful, breathtaking views of the world. So I've been told, you are looking down on the city of Jerusalem and the surrounding hills and valley. Jewish tradition would say that the Messiah was going to descend upon the Mount of Olives, and he would proceed there from Jerusalem, just as Jesus was doing. The city of Jerusalem at that moment had taken on a festive air. It was kind of like Clovis at rodeo time. That's what was going on. The city was heavy with expectancy. You could sense it and feel it in the air. The anxious waiting of a Messiah, the deliverance of God was here. The prophet Isaiah had said that a king one day would reign in righteousness. The lyrics of Isaiah were part of the history of Israel. The foreboding of Jeremiah was a part of their heritage. The condemnation of the prophet Amos was in their national memory. And here now was the hope of the city coming on a young donkey. Jerusalem was the natural place for God to come and offer His love to the world. The Hebrews had heard the thunder of God at Mount Sinai. One of the ancestors had wrestled with God near there. It was the city of David. It was the place of rest for the Ark of the Covenant. The temple had been built in the heart of the city. Upon this mount, Jesus directs His disciples to go borrow a colt for Him to ride. And they obtain the colt, and they simply tell the owner, "The Lord needs it." It's very interesting to note, if you were to read Matthew, Mark, as well as Luke, that in the retelling of this story, Matthew and Mark miss an aspect that you and I just read in Luke's version. Both Matthew and Mark have Jesus descending the mount and entering the city, but Luke, he sees something the others don't. He notices that Jesus pauses for a moment. After the crowds have finished their cheering and their screaming, after the applause of the people die down, after that moment of euphoric exhilaration is gone, he witnesses Jesus, the Son of God, beholding the city, and he weeps over her. I wonder what Jesus sees. What's going on? What's happening in this city that makes God cry? Jesus looks down. He sees the buildings on Mount Zion. He sees the bronze doors of the temple. He probably notices the shining dome that's blazing in the morning sun. He sees the place of Herod. He sees the Damascus Road off in the distance. It's a place where one day Jesus will meet Paul face to face. He sees the pool of Siloam in the valley. It's known as the healing pool. He sees the people in the marketplace, and then he realizes those profiteers are making an exorbitant amount of profit they're doing in the courts of the temple. He sees the city of Jerusalem as a whole, but he sees so much more. What breaks the heart of Jesus, I believe, is that he looks down at Jerusalem and he sees a city that abuses the poor. You remember the story of that Jesus told of the rich man and Lazarus? Jesus saw that scenario played out again and again and again. You see, the poor were exploited by unfair weights and measures. In a city that had plenty, the poor were left to beg for crumbs from the table of the rich. In a city with growing housing developments, these poor individuals were abandoned to live in the alleyways of the downtown streets. Jesus also notices a city that neglects its children. Children at the point of their greatest need are neglected and they are miseducated. Their potential is stifled by practices and policies and places more value on things than it does on people. Jesus sees a city that abuses women. They are used for pleasure and exploitation by men as temple prostitutes, and the church was at the very heart of the abuse going on. They are relegated to thankless and meaningless jobs. Not only are women physically abused, but mentally abused. This is a city of Jerusalem that makes God cry. Jesus, as he looks at the city, he sees not just the streets, but he sees the people who live on the street. People who call his name, but they are not loyal to him. People going through the motions of religion and worship, but they lack the power of God in their lives. He notices people who sing the songs of Zion, but they lack a commitment of spirit and heart. People who simply are performers rather than participants. People who talk about ethical behavior, but they do not practice the presence of God in their everyday business activities. People who know the law, but they don't obey the spirit of truth. People who are materialistic with no spiritual depth at all. Jesus beholds a city, but he sees so much more. He notices downtown development, but uptown despair. Stadiums full, brim full, but schools that are lacking so much. Young men drifting, young women lost. Political promises with corruption in high places. Religious leaders, but no spiritual leadership. Jesus draws near the city. He stops and he weeps. He weeps because as he draws near, we don't feel the thrill of his presence. He weeps because as he draws near, he hears our pious words, but he knows we reject him and we crucify him in our hearts. He weeps because he knows that we are living by our wits and not by our faith. He weeps because he knows we are motivated by the things we dislike and not by our love for him. He He weeps because we are anxious and fretful all the time instead of confident in His love. He weeps because of our sinfulness. He weeps, and yet what does He do? He rides on into the city. I think Jesus may have had in the forefront of His thoughts as He rides that donkey into Jerusalem the words that the third person of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit, had moved upon the heart of the writer of Chronicles to pen so many decades and centuries before this moment. I believe Jesus certainly could have had at the tip of His tongue these words, "If my people in this city who are called by my name, if they would be willing to take the time to humble themselves, stop thinking about themselves and think about me and humble themselves in my presence, and if they would be willing to pray, if they would be willing to seek my face, my direction, my will, if they would do that, they would turn from that which they think is righteous but I have deemed as wicked, then I will hear their cries from heaven. I will forgive their sin. And I will heal their land." Guys, I got news for you. The condition of our nation is not going to be solved by a ballot box in 2 weeks. The only healing for our nation is going to come when you and I hit our knees on a regular basis regarding our life, the life of those we know, the life of our community that we are a part of, a life of the nation that God has blessed us to be a part of. And we have been told not to forsake Him and to take that message literally around the world. I want to thank God today that the Lord Jesus did not stop at the top of the Mount of Olives. Thank God He didn't stop and turn around and go in a different direction, but He fulfilled the prophecies of Isaiah in 53, verses 4, 5, and 6, when He says, "Surely He has borne our grief. He, riding that donkey, carried our sorrows. Yet we did not esteem Him as stricken or smitten of God and afflicted. But Jesus, riding this donkey, was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon Him, and with His stripes we have been healed. All we, not a one of us left out, every one of us have gone astray. We've turned to our own ways, and the Lord God of heaven, has laid on the Lord Jesus here upon earth the iniquity of every one of us so that we could be forgiven and given a fresh start." Thank God He rides into the city. That's where ministry is. It is where ministry takes place to the least, to the last, and to everyone who is lost. Where need is greatest is where you find Jesus. Thank God He rides into the city. Jesus visits the people who are homeless. He comforts the people who are hopeless. And He encourages the people who are hapless. Thank God Jesus rides on into the city. That's the kind of God that we have. One who will go into the city for you and me. Because it is through the city that we find the cross. Ride on, somebody said. Ride on, King Jesus. Ride on. I didn't say ride on. I said ride on. Isaiah 40, verses 4 and 5 says, "Until every valley shall be lifted up, until every mountain shall be made low, and the crooked paths shall be made straight, and the rough places will be made plain, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it." God wants to make the crooked paths of Clovis and Fresno straight. The question is, will we let Him ride on in your life and in my life to make a difference in the community that we are a part of? You see, the city that makes God cry is the city that Jesus rides through to get to the cross for you and me. What makes a city great and strong? Someone said it's not the architecture's graceful strength. It's not factories and their extended influence, but it's men who see the civic wrong and give their lives to make it right and turn the darkness into light. What makes a city that men can love? Not things that charm the outward senses, nor gross displays of opulence, but right that wrong cannot remove and truth that faces civic fraud and smites it in the name of God. This is a city that shall stand. A light upon a nation's hill, a voice that evil cannot stop, a source of blessing to the land. Its strength is not brick, nor stone, nor wood, but it is justice, love, and the brotherhood of Jesus Christ. God goes to the city that makes him cry because he loves you and he loves me. God wants to ride on the streets of the city, not on a colt anymore. Jesus Christ wants to ride into the city in your life and in your life and in your life and in my life. There are parts of the city you have access to that nobody else does, just like you. Sometimes it's the city right across the street. And sometimes it's a part of the city that's at the school grounds. And sometimes it is in a jury box. And sometimes it's going to the rescue mission. And sometimes it's going to Heinz Hospice. And sometimes it's going to the hospital. And sometimes it's going to places that absolutely scare you to death. But you allow faith to overcome your fear, so that Jesus can look down at the city of Clovis and Fresno, and instead of weeping, he can rejoice because the light is shining brightly of his truth. Are you available? We sang a song, "A Little More of You in the Middle of Me." I think God needs a little more of him in every one of us, so there's a lot more of him in the community that we are a part of. I'm not quite finished today, but we're going to pray. There may be some of you here that God has spoken to you in these last several minutes. There's been some things he's been working in your heart for weeks or months, and you just keep putting it on the back burner. And today, you discover that God has been crying over our city because there's more members of his congregation just like you that he's been nudging and pushing and driving and saying, "Hey, this is where I want you to go. This is where I want you to shine my light. I want to use you just as I used that man's young colt. I want to use you to make a difference in the cities of Clovis and Fresno." It may be in teaching a Sunday school class. It might be volunteering for Celebrate Recovery. It might be a willingness to go and to work out of the rescue mission. Or you may just simply come and say, "Pastor, here is what God has put on my heart. Where's a place I can get engaged in doing this?" Today's the day to stop putting it off. Today's the day to stop saying, "Well, you know, I'm kind of retired now." It's time to stop saying, "You know, when I get retired, I'll have time." It's time to quit saying, "You know, when I'm a little older, when I got a little more resources in the bank." No, sorry. The scripture says it this way: today is the day of salvation. Now, not later, is the accepted time. You could be the person who goes to the cardiologist and he tells you your heart is healthy, something else will take you before your heart does, and you die of cardiac arrest 3 weeks later. This is the day. You see, there was a very wicked man who had the opportunity to leave his wickedness and to turn to Christ. And do you know what he said to that invitation? "You know, I think I'll wait for a more convenient time." We have lived too long at convenience. It's time we're inconvenienced a bit for the sake of the gospel. So maybe you need to pray about that. There might even be a couple of you here who you don't know Jesus Christ personally. You're not even sure why you showed up at New Hope today. And you certainly had no intention of hearing a particular message like this today. But maybe you've discovered that Jesus has looked at the city and he's been crying over you because you have resisted an invitation for him to come live in your life and to have fellowship with you, to forgive you of your sins, to save you from yourself, to promise you a home in heaven, and between today and the day that he calls you home, to have all that he is living in you for everything that you need as you face the challenges, the troubles, and the difficulties of this world. You can do it now with his presence in you. Maybe there's a few of you who need to pray a prayer like that. So would you pause with me for just a moment and let's pray. Our Father, you didn't come to save us just so that we go to heaven and not to hell when we die. But Father, you came to forgive us and to save us so that between now and the time that you call us to eternity, that you can express yourself through us. You express yourself with peace and joy and contentment. But you also express yourself in love as we share this wonderful gift that we have so graciously been given. And you want us to be selfless with that gift and to share this precious gift of promise to those that we love. You even want us to share it with those that we find it difficult to love, because we in our finiteness, we're awful picky about who we love. But Father, you and your grace love every one of us while we were still sinners. There are big sinners and little sinners. There's just all who fall short of the glory of God. So Father, if there's a man or a woman who's here today and they want to invite you to come live in their life, then I pray they'll pray something like this, using their very own words. But God, I need you. I've ran from you long enough. I've done my own thing long enough. I'm ready for you to come live within my life. Forgive me of my sin. I know I have been alienated from you. I know that I've been sinful, and I want you to forgive me of all of that. Take away my guilt and condemnation. Come live within my life. I can't wait to learn more about you and grow in this relationship that's called the Christian life. So, Father, I want to begin that today. I don't want to wait another moment. I don't want to postpone it another day, because today is the moment I've been. Thank you, Father, for hearing that prayer at this very moment. Thank you that you heard it and you answered it. You answered it, Father, because of truth, not because of feeling. Sometimes we pray that prayer, we cry. Sometimes we pray that prayer, we laugh. Sometimes people pray that prayer and nothing seems to be different at the moment. This is a prayer of faith in truth. Sometimes there's emotions with it and sometimes there's not. But the truth is, if we honestly confess, you truthfully forgive. Father, for the vast majority of us in this room, we have been your children for months and years and decades. Maybe it's time we allowed you to have a greater expression. Maybe it's time we let you use us as the colt that takes you into the heart of the city. May you find us willing to say yes to the nudges, to the whispers that you've been sharing in our spirit. May we not postpone any longer saying, God, I'm yours. I'll go to whoever you send me. I'll share your truth, your love, your grace to those you provide opportunity. I want to be your hands. I want to be your feet. I want to be your lips. I want to be used by you. Thank you for hearing our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I want to wrap up in just a couple of minutes. I hope you understand that at New Hope, as a church body, we are engaged in a lot of community outreach already. We do it as a church body. Every little bit that you give and that you care, God puts together in his pool, and you have given direction to your elders and your pastoral staff. They have suggested leadership and direction, and you have responded in various ways. And I just want to remind you some of the areas in which we are engaged in. That engagement financially doesn't need to prevent us from being engaged personally. Sometimes we use finances as a means of not being engaged hands-on. God, I believe, wants both from us, all right? He wants our resources, not just of our tithes and our money, but he wants the resources of our life as well. And here are a few of the areas I hope you will recognize as community engagement. We monthly are engaged in support through Welcome Home and Prison Fellowship. And that is caring for the incarcerated and the recently released. And the Bible tells us we are to go to the prisons and take the message of freedom in Christ. We engage in monthly support of Love Incorporated. Actually, it's Love Inc. Love in the Name of Christ. INC is what it stands for. And love helps the churches be the church. It helps us help people with real needs, because there's a lot of con artists out there who think the church is an easy touch to get financial resources. And quite frankly, we are. You tell us a really sad story, our hearts are moved and we feel like we need to be engaged. But there's a lot of con artists who do that. And Love Inc. helps the church to really put the money where it's needed most. And so they help us with that. Fresco Rescue Mission. They help the homeless and the hungry and so many others in our community. Just this past week, we had a small group from our church go and be part of the fundraising benefits of the Rescue Mission. We have had outreaches through the Rescue Mission. And part of what our homeless ministry will talk about next week is our ongoing engagement in that. Aviation in Action. This is a ministry started by a member of our old church and now a member of our staff, Mark Addis, taking planes and pilots and raising funds, and we help contribute to that so they can transport those who are seriously ill for treatment in parts of the state that you can't get here in the Central Valley. And without this assistance, they have no hope for any future. And so we help in that area. Child Evangelism Fellowship, which offers the name of Jesus Christ to children and after-school program activities. We also are engaged in ministries through our campus and Celebrate Recovery and Grief Share, helping those with hurts, habits, hang-ups, and dealing with loss in their lives. I've already shared with you about October 26th coming up at the People's Church with our kids and about Renew with Palau and Chan coming up later in the month of November. And so those are just some of the ways that you are engaged as a church body in making a difference in the community. And my challenge to you today is take great joy, I think, and praise. God, thank you that we have a heart for our community. And then I want you to take that a step further. What does that mean now for you personally at the stage of life that you are in? How can God use you to make a difference in this community, one person, one neighborhood, one block at a time? That's my challenge for you today. Ushers, will you come forward and receive our second offering? And this is all going to the Luis Palau Crusade called Fresno City Fest coming on April 1st and 2nd. I hope you get those dates on your calendar. I know it's Big Hat Day in the city of Clovis, but I think we can do both, okay? I think we can accomplish both those things. Let's pray. Father, for the privilege of giving, we say thanks. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Would you please wait on us? I will dismiss you in just a moment. Do you have any questions about Fresno City Fest that I might be able to answer? Any questions? You may also put these cards, if you didn't get them filled out before the offering, with the names on it. You may put those in this offering. But any questions of any kind? There's not a stupid question. They will be recruiting help, and we will be getting that information by the end of November. There's going to be a need for counselors. There'll be a need probably for ushers. There's going to be follow-up that will be necessary. So, yes, there will be a need for volunteers. Okay, the front half of the audience, you may be dismissed through these side doors right here. You can get up and you can come out through the side doors while they are finishing taking the off through the back doors.